good to be in the house of the Lord, and I'm so glad that we get this opportunity to give him thanks and to give him praise. Hallelujah.
I was glad when they said unto me.
We bless your name, Jesus. We bless your name, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. God, we thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your mercies. We thank you for your grace, God. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We adore you, Jesus. We magnify your name, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You're worthy, Jesus.
Of the goodness of God. in the Word today, if you'd be so kind to turn with me to the Book of Chronicles. And while you're turning there, I'm just going to say it. Remember our young people in prayer, especially remember those who are serving in the military, particularly Maurice. Things are getting a little bit interesting and precarious. And so we want to pray that God would cover him, that whatever will be in terms of where he may potentially be moved to or based in, that God would cover him and protect him. For those who don't know, it is very trepidatious right now on the international stage. And so just remember him. And also Brother Swanson's son, thank you. Just remember him as well. And if you have any other family members who are in the military, please let us know. We want to really pray for them, that God would cover them and protect them. Amen. Praise God. Turn to 2 Chronicles chapter 20, and it's going to be on the screen. We're going to kind of traverse through the scriptures, various verses and points of this passage. My wife shared a wonderful word last week. Amen. She shared a wonderful word. And as she was speaking from this passage, the Lord is also speaking to me. And I want to respond with what the Lord has said to me. So we're going to look at 2 Chronicles 20. We'll start at verse 1 through 4. And then we will continue throughout. And so just jump along with me as we go through the word of the Lord. And the Bible says here in 2 Chronicles chapter 21 through 4, the Bible says, and it came to pass after this also, that the children of Moab and the children of Ammon, and with them, other beside the Ammonites, came against Jehoshaphat to battle. Then there came some that told Jehoshaphat, saying, there cometh a great multitude against thee from beyond the sea on this side Syria, and behold, they be in Hazon Tamar, which is in Gedi. And Jehoshaphat feared, and set himself to seek the Lord, and proclaimed a fast throughout all Judah. And Judah gathered themselves together to ask help of the Lord. Even out of all the cities of Judah, they came to seek the Lord. Verse 12, look at verse 12 now. And they prayed, our God, wilt thou not judge them? For we have no might against this great company that cometh against us, neither know we what to do, but our eyes are upon thee. Verse 13, and all of Judah stood before the Lord with their little ones, with their wives, and with their children. Look at verse 15 and 17. And he said, hearken ye, all Judah, this is God speaking, and ye inhabitants of Jerusalem, and thou King Jehoshaphat, the Lord says, thus saith the Lord unto you, be not afraid or dismayed by reason of this great multitude, for the battle is not yours, but God's. Verse 17 says, and ye shall not need to fight in this battle. Set yourselves, stand ye still, and see the salvation of the Lord with you. O Judah and Jerusalem, fear not, nor be dismayed. Tomorrow go out against them, for the Lord will be with you. I want you to look now at verse 19 and 20. And the Levites and the children of the Kohathites and the children of the Korahites stood up to praise the Lord God of Israel with a loud voice on high. And they rose early in the morning and went forth into the wilderness of Tekoa. And as they went forth, Jehoshaphat stood and said, hear me, O Judah, and ye inhabitants of Jerusalem, believe in the Lord your God, so shall ye be established, believe in his prophets, so shall ye prosper. And when he had consulted with the people, he appointed singers unto the Lord, that they should praise the beauty of holiness. And as they went out before the army, and to say, praise the Lord, for his mercy endureth forever. And when they began to sing and praise, the Lord set ambushments against the children of Ammon, Moab, and Mount Seir, which were come against Judah, and they were smitten. And then Judah came towards the watchtower in the wilderness, and they looked on the multitude, and behold, there were dead bodies fallen to the earth, and none escaped. Look at verse 26 and last. And the Bible says, and on the fourth day they assembled themselves in the valley of Berakah, for there they blessed the Lord. Therefore the name of the same place was called the valley of Berakah until this day. We all say
amen.
Amen. Let us pray. Father, we thank you today for your word. We thank you for your presence and power. We thank you, God, that you have now inhabited yourself in this place as we have worshiped you.
Thank you, Jesus.
And Heavenly Father, as your word goes forth, we look to hear from you.
Yes, Lord.
We look to receive a word that ministers unto us, considering where we are today. And so we pray, oh God, that you would speak by the power of the Holy Ghost.
Yes, Lord.
And cause us to receive in our lives what you are saying to us, that we would be healed, that we would be delivered, that we would receive clarity of thought and direction.
Yes, Lord.
We thank you and we give you praise.
Thank you, Jesus.
In Jesus' name we all say
amen.
Amen and amen. And so I want to share here today on the Valley of Blessing. The Valley of Blessing. First Lady shared a wonderful message last week on the Valley of Blessing, and I want to really just continue that today. And last week we focused specifically here on verse 26 about the valley and it being the place of blessing. But today I want to take a step back and have us take a broader look at the context that brought us to verse 26. And when we read this chapter, we read this chapter as it opens up to us reading that Israel was under attack by Moab, by Ammon, and another unnamed faction. And we read here, it's interesting because we read here that Moab was leading the charge. And this is interesting because if you read back in 2 Kings chapter 3, you'll read that Moab, and you'll read about Moab rebelling against Israel. And it was Jehoshaphat, King Jehoshaphat, who fought alongside Israel to put down Moab's rebellion. Now at that time and at the time here in Kings and in Chronicles, Israel is in a state, if you remember, after Solomon died and his son took the kingdom. The kingdom was split in two. And you had Israel and then you had Judah. Israel had a king that reigned over Israel and Judah had a king that reigned over Judah. And so Solomon was the king of Judah. And at that time, Joram was the king of Israel. And Moab rebelled against Israel, and Jehoshaphat came to the aid, Jehoshaphat and Judah came to the aid of Israel to put down the rebellion of Moab. And so King Jehoshaphat, literally in 2 Kings, went out of his way to help Israel put down that Moab rebellion. But yet here now in 2 Chronicles, what nation is coming up against Israel? It's Moab. Mm-hmm. Now Moab has set their sights on Judah. And I read that, I said, that's interesting. Mm. Because what this tells us and teaches us is that we have to be careful of what or who we get involved with. Uh-huh. Because sometimes somebody else's battle can become your own.
That's true.
In other words, it's not every battle that we see that we must fight. Uh-huh. Uh-huh. It's not every burden that we see that we are called to carry.
That's it.
Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Now, if God is leading you to pick up a burden, pick it up, because if God is leading you to pick it up, that means God is going to equip you to carry that burden.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But we have to be mindful of what we get ourselves involved in. Mm-hmm. because somebody's problem can suddenly become our own. And here is Judah, who simply went out to help Israel, and now guess what's happening? Moab is now coming for Judah.
My Lord.
And while it seemed at the time the right thing to do, Jehoshaphat said to Israel, "You are my brother. I'm going to come. I'm going to fight with you." You know, and at the time it seemed like the right thing to do, but it came back to bite Judah and Jehoshaphat and his nation. And the fact that we see Moab now able to attack Judah, it tells us something else. It tells us that Judah, when they fought Moab, Judah defeated Moab in that season. Judah defeated Moab at that time, but they did not destroy Moab. You see, we have to understand that there are battles that we win over the enemy, but there are battles in which we need to destroy what the enemy is doing. We have to understand that even though we may win a battle today, it doesn't mean that the enemy won't come back to fight again. In Israel, they won the battle. But what they didn't do, and Judah, they won that battle against Moab, but what they didn't do is they didn't destroy the enemy. In other words, what we allow to linger in our lives, what we allow to linger in and around our lives will always carry the potential to become a Moab in our lives. And the fact of the matter is that there may be some trials that we're going through now that are literally Moabs in our lives. Something that we should have dealt with. Something that we should have put down entirely. Something that we should have just put out of commission. But we had a win and we felt good about it, so we kind of just turned away and just left it alone, but it wasn't dead.
My Lord.
We must be careful of what we allow to linger in and around our lives.
Amen.
Israel and Judah, they won the battle in 2 Kings. They felt good about the battle that they won in 2 Kings. And they left Moab only to find out years later that Moab was back. And when we read in the text, it wasn't just Moab. But Moab brought Ammon with them. And Moab also brought another unobscure nation with them.
My Lord.
When we do some digging upon who that nation is, we learn that this nation is the Menuhites. So there are three nations. And this is interesting because the first time Judah knew about Moab, and they fought Moab. They knew about Ammon, and throughout the history, they fought against Ammon. But here is somebody that they've never faced before. This third nation, the Menuhites, this was a new foe. A nation they had never faced before. In other words, when we let things linger and fester, we will find out that we will have new problems to deal with. We'll find out that problems that weren't there the first time are there the second or third time. Are you hearing me today? And Jesus himself warned us about these ramifications of unfinished battles. When you read in Matthew chapter 12, verse 43 through 45, Jesus said, "And when the unclean spirit is gone out of a man, and he walketh through dry places, seeking rest, and findeth none, then he saith, I will return into my house from whence I came out. And when he has come, he findeth empty, swept, and garnished. Then goeth he and taketh with him seven other spirits more wicked than himself. And they enter in and they dwell there, and the last state of that man is worse than the first."
My Lord.
"Even so shall it be unto this wicked generation." And so Jesus is teaching us it is not enough just to kick them out. You got to kick them out and keep them out. You got to kick them out and literally put them out.
Amen.
Remove all possibilities for the enemy or that situation to linger. And therefore maybe there is someone who you have unresolved issues with. Maybe there's someone, or just maybe there's a situation that is not really resolved right now. And maybe you feel okay just leaving it alone. I'm just not going to touch it. Because it was a situation. The situation seemed to quiet down. I'm not going to stir that pot. But there may come a day when you will have to cross that bridge to get to where God is leading you. Jacob left his home, and the last thing he heard his brother say was, "The next time I see you, I'm going to kill you." And God told Jacob, it's time to go back to the place where I promised your fathers. But in order to get back to where Jacob needed to go, he had to pass through the land of his brother, who said, "The next time I see you, I'm going to kill you." We got to be mindful of that. Amen.
Amen.
Jehoshaphat fought against Moab, and he let them linger. But now we read that Moab is coming back stronger than he left them. So be careful. We have to be careful of what we leave behind. You may think it's behind you. You may think it's dead.
So true.
You make sure that you put an end to it. Make sure you put an end to the bitterness. You know what? I think I'm over it. I'm not going to address it. We just leave it there. No, put an end to the bitterness. Amen?
Yes.
Maybe the hatred is just lingering somewhere back there. Don't just let it sit there. Put an end to it. It's hard to forgive at times, and therefore maybe that issue is still sitting there. No, God is saying, don't let it linger. It can become a Moab in your life.
Amen.
We read that Moab was on a revenge tour, and they were only focused on Judah. I found that interesting. Moab came out against Judah. And Israel was not in a position to help Judah. Isn't that something else? Israel was not in a position to help Judah. Judah went to help Israel. And now when Judah needed Israel's help,
my God,
Israel was nowhere to be found. It's amazing how you can be there for others, but when you need them, they're nowhere to be found. Has this ever happened to you? Where someone's problem over time literally becomes your problem? Where you just showed up just to help real quick? And over time, now you're carrying the weight of all of it. Tell somebody, watch out for the Moabites.
Watch out for the Moabites.
Watch out, watch out, watch out. Now, we read in verse 3 of Chronicles, of 2 Chronicles 20, that somebody came, they ran to the king, and they said, "King, listen, Moab is on their way. And they're bigger, they're stronger than before." And they said, "King, not only is Moab coming, but Ammon is coming with them. And not only is Ammon coming with them, the Menuhites are coming from that direction, from Syria."
Wow.
And the Bible says, when King Jehoshaphat heard this, the Bible says he feared. When King Jehoshaphat heard this, the Bible says that he feared. Now, some would say, why was he afraid? You telling me that Jehoshaphat lacked faith because he feared, the Bible says. It says there. It says he feared. We would say, shouldn't King Jehoshaphat have never been afraid at all? What was he afraid of? He's king. But the truth is, there are situations in life that will strike fear in our hearts.
That's true.
The truth is, there are situations that will strike us with fear. And listen, maybe your life has been real good. Maybe you ain't gone through nothing. And maybe you've never had to experience the extremeness of walking into an unexpected situation or circumstance. Maybe life has been real good, but listen, there are situations that will absolutely strike fear in our hearts.
So true.
You see, what fear is a reactionary emotion. Fear is a reactionary emotion that is born out of our sin nature. And therefore, we will all have moments of fear. You can think of fear in terms of a reactionary emotion. You can think of fear as a sound alarm. Like your alarm when you're waking up. If you gotta get up early, you don't put on some soft music, amen? If you gotta get up early and you know you're tired, you don't put on no soft, serene music. You put on a loud sound that will alarm you and wake you up, amen? Think of fear as that sound alarm. Something that is designed to perk us up or to widen our eyes, to wake us up. But listen to me closely. Fear is an emotional alarm bell. It is not a lifestyle. Fear is an alarm. It is not a lifestyle. Can you imagine going through the entire day with your alarm going off?
No.
The whole day you get in your car, get to work, Imagine living a lifestyle of your alarm constantly, perpetually being on. You're trying to pray, you're trying to worship, everything you do. Trying to have a conversation, the alarm is going off. Can you imagine living your whole life with your alarm on?
No.
That's no way to live. And this is why we must take a closer look at what the word tells us in 2 Timothy 1:7. The Bible says God has not given us a what? A spirit of fear. God's not given us a spirit of fear. Do you remember what the word spirit means in this specific context? The word spirit in this specific context, and actually in the Greek, the word spirit in this passage is defined as mannerisms. It is defined as lifestyle. And so what the word is saying, God has not given us a mannerism of fear in which we live a lifestyle of fear. You following me today? In other words, just because something may strike you with fear, it doesn't mean you're going to live in that fear.
That's right.
Just because something strikes you with fear, that situation happened, boom, that thing happened. You say, oh my goodness, it hits you with fear. But the Bible said God has not given you a spirit of fear. God has not given you the mannerism in which you will live in fear. And this is why God warned Cain back in Genesis 4, verse 7. God told him, he said, listen, if you do well, shall you not be accepted? And then God said, and if thou doest not well, he said, sin lieth at the door, and unto thee shall be his desire. But what? Thou shalt rule over him. Now, the Bible also says that it is impossible, without faith, it is impossible to what?
Please God.
Please God. And so, therefore, living in fear robs us of the ability to walk in faith. And so, therefore, living in fear is sinful. And the word is telling us in Genesis that we shall rule over sin. And so the word is saying that when sin attempts to not just knock at the door of your heart, but when fear attempts to get in the door, when fear attempts to live with you, when fear attempts to marry itself to your life, the Bible is saying you have to rule over it.
Amen.
You got to say, fear, you're not going to live here.
That's right.
Say, okay, fear, you hit me once, get outside and stay out there. I'm not going to live in fear. Tell somebody, rule over it. Tell somebody, rule over it.
Rule over it.
Yes, we got to rule over it. You see, there are so many people who literally allow fear to dominate their lives. There's so many people who literally allow fear to make decisions for them.
So true.
Fear makes choices for them. They do things or they don't do things because of fear. They make decisions based on fear. But God has not called us to live in a place of fear concerning our lives. Mm-hmm. And so when we look at Jehoshaphat and we look at his response, the Bible says Jehoshaphat feared. That is human nature. He feared. But listen, or rather look at the response. And this struck me. We learn an important lesson here. The Bible says Jehoshaphat feared, but how did he respond?
He sought the Lord.
Jehoshaphat feared, and the Bible says, and he set himself. He feared in that moment. And watch this. The fear that hit him, his reaction was, I'm going to now set myself. In other words, I'm going to change everything I'm doing. I'm going to change everything I'm doing to make sure I'm seeking God.
Yes.
This thing hit my life. And so Jehoshaphat said, I'm not. And so he said, considering what's happening, I'm not going to do what I usually do in prayer. I'm not just going to do what I usually do in fasting. He says, no, I'm going to pivot my life. I'm going to set myself to seek God.
Yes.
He set himself to seek God. And the Bible specifically says in this verse, Jehoshaphat feared and. Jehoshaphat feared and he. And so the question that I want to ask us today is, what happens after the and in our lives? What happens after the and we fear, and what happens after that? What happens? Do we fear and then we cry? Do we fear and then we just lay down and quit? Do we fear and then we just find someone to be depressed with us? Do we fear and then we just literally shut down? Do we fear and then we just stop praying, stop worshiping, stop reading the word? What happens after the and in our lives? Jehoshaphat had a seemingly natural response to two moments of fear in his life. When fear hit his life, he sought after God. And not only that, but then the Bible says Jehoshaphat feared, and he responded by setting himself to seek the Lord, and then he proclaimed a fast throughout all of Israel. He called a fast. In other words, he is saying, I'm going to use everything that God has given me to obtain my victory. Okay, enemy. Okay, devil, you done hit my life. Now it's my turn. Come on, somebody. Okay, devil, now you hit my life. Now it's my turn. Let me show you what God has given me. Let me show you what God has put in my life. Let me show you the weapons of warfare that God has given me. Jehoshaphat said, okay, fear, you hit me. Okay, now it's my turn. I'm going to set myself. And I'm going to seek the Lord. You see, this passage encourages me in terms of reminding me that I can have everything I need from God if I only turn to seek his face.
Hey, what's up, everybody? I want to take a moment to just thank you for listening today. Your support is so important to this ministry. It's just such a blessing. And I just want to encourage you just to take a moment and just hit that like button. When you do that, it goes a long way in helping this ministry spread this message. And it spreads message, and it takes it to places that we cannot go ourselves. And so just hit that like button. Also hit that subscribe button, and also share this with others. Maybe there's a good chance that there's somebody who needs to hear this word today. And so just support us. And listen, and listen, if you feel led to be a blessing to us, even financially, you can actually download the Givly app, and you can search for us, and you'll find us under Fountainside Christian Fellowship. And if you feel led to support us in that way, listen, we appreciate it. God bless you, and we're just so grateful for your support for this ministry. All right, so don't go anywhere. I have a few more words left to share with you. Be blessed by this today.
can have whatever I need from God as long as I turn to seek his face in the way in which God commanded me to. And that is what is important. I have to seek God the way he has commanded me to seek him. And the problem with some believers is that some believers want what I call convenient deliverance. Some believers want what I call convenient deliverance. They want the type of deliverance whereby they do what they want to do in reference to seeking God. And then they'll say, Lord, I've been seeking you. What is going on?
My Lord.
They seek God their way. They seek God the way that fits what they want to do. Oh, but they don't seek God the way God has prescribed for them to seek his face. They have a saying in Jamaica that if you want good, your nose have for what?
Run.
Have for run. And this same Jamaican proverb applies to our spiritual life. If you want to change in your life, you got to dig in.
Yep.
If you want to change in your life, you got to set yourself to see God. If you want that thing to break in your life, you got to set yourself to see God.
Amen.
If you want a transition in your life, you got to set yourself to see God.
Amen.
But the problem for many believers is they want deliverance on their terms rather than doing what God has told them to do. We want to keep the same attitude and we want to seek God. We want to keep the same habits and we want to seek God. We want to keep the same old mindset and we want to seek God. And we want to keep all the stuff that we need to change. We're saying, God, where are you at?
Help me, Lord.
We don't want to pray longer. We don't want to fast. We don't want to read the word. But yet we get mad at God for what he is not doing.
Jesus.
But it's not a matter of what God is not doing. It's a matter of what it is a matter of what it is a matter of what we refuse to do.
That's it.
And the question therefore becomes, will we do what God said in order to get what God has promised us already? And so even though Jehoshaphat was afraid, he didn't turn to others who were afraid. Even though Jehoshaphat was afraid and concerned, he didn't turn to others who were concerned. Even though Jehoshaphat didn't have the answer, he didn't turn to others who did not have the answer. No, but he turned to God. Do you get where I'm going with this? Listen, if you are in depression, don't look for depressed people. Amen?
That's true.
If you're bitter, don't look for bitter people.
Mm-hmm. That's true.
If you're stressed out, don't find the first person you see that is all the way stressed out.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
If your marriage or relationship is struggling, don't try to find single people.
Mm-hmm.
Don't go looking to bitterly divorced people.
Mm-hmm.
Don't do it. Don't even go to struggling couples. Don't look for them toxic couples. It's not going to help you.
Mm-hmm.
Amen? But turn to God, amen?
Yes, yes, amen.
In those moments and in those seasons where we are going through, we need to hear from God.
Amen.
We need to hear from the Lord. You see, somebody can talk to you and they can minister to your emotions. They can talk to you and they can help you in reference to your emotions. But when God speaks, he speaks to your spirit and soul.
Yes.
When God speaks, he speaks in the depths of your
Amen.
Being.
Amen.
He speaks
Amen.
Deep on the inside of you. And my God, when his voice resonates, it changes you internally. It changes you from the inside. It changes everything about you. That's why we need to hear from God. And so listen, I don't know where your struggle is. And listen, I don't know where your difficulty is. But what we hear, or rather what we see in this text, is that Jehoshaphat, in this intrepid moment of fear, he turned to the Lord.
Yes.
And he said, God, I'm coming to you about this.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, God, not only am I going to fast, he says, I'm going to put everybody under my auspices under a fast. He said, I'm going to put the nation on fast. Listen, there are some situations you got to fast through, amen?
Amen.
And some things you got to fast out.
That's true.
But this is the key. In your distress, turn to God.
Yes.
Say, God, I need to hear from you.
Yes, Lord.
Say, God, you see what's happening in my life, and Lord, I don't know what to do. I need a word from you, oh God.
Yes.
We got to say, God, in that moment, speak to my heart. We got to say, God, in that moment, create in me a clean heart. Give me, give me the right mindset. Give me the right attitude in the midst of this fire. Give me the right attitude in the midst of this flood, in the midst of this storm. God, I need to hear from you.
Yes.
We need to seek God, and we need to wait for his answer. And listen to me. And listen, when we're waiting for his answer, do not presuppose his answer. When you are waiting for his answer, don't assume that his answer will be what you are feeling. Sometimes we wait on God and we try to assume what God's going to say. Well, I'm going to sit here and wait for God to tell me what I want him to tell me and what I expect to hear. No, when you go to God, let God say what he's going to say.
Amen.
Wait for his answer. Because the fact of the matter is, our answer likely got us to where we are. Mm. So we need to stop and wait and hear from the Lord. There has been times in my life where I felt justified in my frustration, in my anger. And I tell you, I wanted to hear a word from God that would validate how I felt. I wanted to hear God speak to me and say, yes, son, you are right in how you feel. And listen, I went down on my knees to pray and God corrected me. Mm-hmm. I went down on my knees and God told me about me. I was mad thinking I was justified. And God in prayer, God said, no, son, it's you. He said, not is you. God said, look, here is a mirror of the Holy Ghost. Do you actually see yourself? Oh, my goodness. And I said, okay, Lord, I hear you. I listened for his voice. I didn't listen for what I wanted to hear. I said, God, give me a word. Speak to me. And because I heard his voice and because I responded to his voice, that's when the shift happened in my life. And this is why hearing from God is so important.
So important.
Because God tells us what we need to hear. Listen, if you go to your doctor and you know you have an upper respiratory infection, and your doctor knows what you want to hear. Well, I see you have an upper respiratory. I think you can go home and I'll prescribe for you 3 scoops of ice cream. I'll prescribe for you, I don't know what else y'all like to eat that's unhealthy. I'll prescribe for you, I thank y'all. I will prescribe you half a slice of pizza and a hamburger per day. What kind of doctor is that? You say, no. You say, listen, sir, tell me what I need to take. Don't tell me what I want to take. Don't tell me to take no oxtail as medication for my cholesterol. Right? Tell me what I need.
Yes.
Well, you need to have this. Well, I don't like it, but I need it. I don't approve it, but I need it to get better. Amen, somebody. In the same sense, we have to go to God and say, God, what is happening? And Lord, if it is me, search me, O God. Know me, O God, and see if there be any wicked way in me. Because what the enemy wants is the enemy wants you to stay in that place. Because as long as you stay there, you'll never get to where God wants to take you.
That's true.
And so when we can say, God, what is going on? And God says, well, it's this and it's that and it's that. And we say, okay, God, I surrender. And we change. And we allow the Holy Ghost to bring change in that area. And in that area, suddenly we will find ourselves moving to a place where we need to be. A place where we find fulfillment. A place where we find peace. A place where we find deliverance. A place where we find renewed life and renewed hope. But all of that happens when we are willing to hear his voice regardless of what he is saying. And therefore, it is important for us to get out of self and to throw out our bias, throw out our assumptions, and listen to God's voice.
Yes.
God may say something to you that is encouraging. God may say something to you that is inspiring. Mm-hmm. But God may also correct you. Mm-hmm. God may also redirect you. Listen for his voice. And so therefore Jehoshaphat turned immediately in prayer And this is a prayer that Jehoshaphat prayed. I want to point out a few things that he said in his prayer that I think is meaningful. Jehoshaphat turned to God in prayer. And when you read the prayer that Jehoshaphat gives unto the Lord, it is, in terms of its literary style, it is in a form of a question. His prayer is seemingly in a form of a question. But his questions were not literal, but his questions were rhetorical. They were more so a statement in the form of a question, reminding himself and reminding everybody there of who God is. And Jehoshaphat prayed, and he said, O Lord God of our fathers. He said, O Lord God of our fathers. This part of his prayer refers to the quality of enduring, timeless relationship that God has kept with Israel. Jehoshaphat is really declaring, he's saying, look, God, you've been faithful all this time. When he says, O Lord God of our fathers, he's saying, you have been our God since the days of our fathers. He's saying, you have been faithful. And therefore, he's saying, if you've been faithful before, Yes. You will be faithful again. Yes. Amen. And therefore, he's reminding us that, listen, God is the God of all time. He is the God who has kept his covenant all the way back from Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Tell somebody, God is faithful.
God is faithful.
And then he said, O Lord God of our Father, art thou not God in heaven? And when Jehoshaphat prayed those words, this is a declarative reminder of the scope of God's authority and power. Keep in mind, this everything he is saying is on the backdrop of Moab already on their way. Ammon is already on their way. The Midianites are already on their way. And he's saying, God, art thou not the God in heaven? This is Jehoshaphat reminding himself and others that, of God's authority and power. In other words, if God is the God of heaven, that means he is the God of earth. That's if right. God is a God of heaven, that means he is the God of That's everything.
Right. That's right.
Amen. Amen. And so listen, I don't know what power is trying to reign in and over your life, but God sent me to remind you of who he is, that God is God of heaven and earth, that God is God of heaven and earth and everything above the earth and everything beneath the earth. God is reminding you today that I am God. He's saying, I am God in every situation that you are going through.
Hallelujah.
And then Jehoshaphat prayed and he said, Lord, in thy hand is there not power and might, so that none shall be able to withstand thee? Jehoshaphat is affirming that, listen, it doesn't matter what others are doing to you. It doesn't matter what others are saying about you. It doesn't matter what they're doing to you. If God is standing with you, nobody can withstand him.
Amen. Amen.
If God is standing with you, nobody can withstand him. Yeah. Egypt thought that they could withstand God. Mm-hmm. And God made a way out of no way. Mm-hmm. All the haters in Daniel's life, they thought that lions couldn't withstand eating him in that lion's den, but they found out that the lions that were meant for Daniel were actually meant for them.
Wow.
If God is standing with you, mm-hmm. nobody can withstand Amen. God. That's where the Bible says, greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. You don't need to rely on your strength. Rely on God. Amen. You don't need to rely on your power. Yes. Rely on his power. You listen. You don't need to rely on your reliability. Rely on God's reliability. Amen. And this is why Jehoshaphat was seeking God, because Jehoshaphat understood who God is. Mm-hmm. And that's why he said, art thou not our God? In other words, not only He says, art thou not only our God who didst drive out the inhabitants of this land before thy people Israel? First of all, he recognizes God to be his personal God. He's saying, Lord, you belong to us and we belong to you. Mm-hmm. I'm going to tell somebody, you belong to God.
Yes.
That's why you'll never be ashamed.
Thank you.
You belong to God. God will never let you be ashamed. And not only that, but he is the God who drove out the heathen before and fulfilled his promise. Jehoshaphat is rehearsing the reality that Israel is the seed of Abraham who received the promise. And therefore what he is saying, God, if Moab, Ammon, and the Ammonites wipe us out, they're wiping out the promise of Abraham. Mm-hmm. And he is saying, God, we know that you are God in whom your promise never fails. Mm-hmm. And so therefore, King Jehoshaphat is reminding everybody that God is a promise keeper, that God will keep his word.
Hallelujah.
You can stand. I don't know what God has promised you, but you can stand on the promises of God.
Yes.
God will carry you to your promise. Listen, do not let go of your promise. Maybe you've been discouraged. Maybe it's been 5 years. Maybe it's been 10 years. Maybe it's been a couple decades. Do not let go of your promise.
Amen.
Do not let go of your blessing.
Yes.
Do not let go of your deliverance. God promised it to you. Do not let go of your breakthrough. Okay. That is your promise. And listen, I know it looks rough. I know it feels rough. But listen, do not let go of the promise.
Amen.
Do not go of the promise. Yes, it's a struggle, but don't let go. Tell somebody, don't let go.
Don't let go.
Come on, tell them, don't let go.
No.
I know it's a struggle, but don't let go. I know it's painful, but do not let go.
Okay.
I know it is a lonely valley, but tell somebody, don't let go.
Don't let go.
Don't let go. Don't let go. And Jehoshaphat concludes in verse 12 asking, he said, will you not judge them? For he says, for we don't have the strength, nor do we know what to do, but our eyes are upon thee. Don't miss this. This is a moment of selfless confession. Don't underestimate how unique this is. This is a man who has the entire nation at his beck and call. He has all authority. He has all power. He still has a military with him. This is a man of absolute authority. And he's saying before the people, and he's saying to God, look, God, we don't have the strength.
Mm.
Maybe that's somebody there, you're saying the same thing in your life. I don't have the strength.
Mm-hmm.
He's saying, God, we don't have the strength and the might against what's coming against us. And he said, neither know we what to do. You see, this is not defeatism. King Jehoshaphat is not speaking defeatism. He's not speaking faithlessness, but he's speaking a word of faith. He's saying, God, I don't have the strength to do it, but our eyes are upon you. Why are our eyes upon you? Because you have the strength.
Yes.
Because, Lord, you know what to do.
Yes.
And this word of faith was confirmed in verse 15. When the prophet spoke, as the Lord gave him utterance, he said, thus saith the Lord unto you, be not afraid. Tell somebody, don't be afraid. Yeah, don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. Nor be dismayed by reason of this great multitude. God is saying, I know the multitude is coming. Listen, God sees what's happening in your life.
Mm-hmm.
He sees what's happening. God said, I know the multitude is coming, for the battle is not yours, but the battle is the Lord's.
Mm-hmm.
Some will look at this as a unique, rare situation in which God is taking up a battle in a literal sense. They look at this as a one-time event. God is going to fight the battle for them. This doesn't happen often. This is extremely rare for God. This is rare for God to fight for them. People treat this as a one-in-a-lifetime event. But We need to understand that this can be an everyday situation in our lives. Mm-hmm. If we allow God to fight for us.
Yes.
Look here at what the word says in 2 Chronicles 16, verse 19. The Bible says, "For the eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the whole earth to show himself strong in the behalf of them whose heart is perfect towards him." What this passage is saying, is that God is looking for someone who he can show up for. God is looking for somebody who he can fight for.
Yes.
And so when we can confess our deficiencies, when we can admit that we don't have the answer, or when we can admit that we are not the answer, that is when God is able to step in and fight the battle for
us. Yes.
And it's not that God is held back due to some power or some type of authority that we have over him. But God has made us free will beings. God will never force his will upon our lives. God will not force his presence and power upon our lives. We must allow God to accomplish that in our lives. And we do this by obtaining this Jehoshaphat quality of faith, where in our moment of fear, we turn and we set ourselves to seek God. We do this when we can say, "God, I don't know what to do, and I don't have the strength to make it on my own." You see, the truth is there are too many who are trying to fight God's battle for themselves. But at some point, we need to sit down and say, "God, I don't know what to do. I don't have the strength, but my eyes are upon you."
Yes, Lord.
My eyes are upon you, God, not the pain. My eyes are upon you.
Mm-hmm.
My eyes are upon you, God, not the betrayal, but my eyes are upon you. My eyes are upon you. And God is asking, where are your eyes today? Where are our eyes today? And not only that, but verse 13 says something that stood out to me as we close. Verse 13 says that all of Judah stood before the Lord with their little ones, with their wives and their children. The word is telling us that not only ought we to turn ourselves individually, but with our families, encourage our families. Let us turn to God in prayer. Let us place our eyes, set our eyes upon the Lord. We must teach our children to turn to God. Amen.
Amen.
We got to teach our kids to turn to God.
Yes.
We got to teach our kids to look to God.
Mm-hmm.
Because if we don't teach them, the world will teach them.
Mm-hmm. Sure will.
If we don't teach them, the world will teach them.
Mm-hmm.
And the world will teach them where to look.
Mm-hmm.
And where they look will become who they become.
My God.
And therefore, if our children do not have a foundation, they will be led into all sorts of ungodly mindsets and lifestyles. But as they... Now, what is interesting about this text is that you read that God instructed Israel to meet the enemy at the cliff. And the fact that the Bible says a cliff, it indicates that they were entering into a valley. And valleys are universally known as a place of battle. And valleys were used as places of battle because it gives leverage to the one who sits on top of the valley. Because if you're on top of the valley, you can see everything that is happening in the bottom of the valley. And therefore you can give instructions based on the top side view that you have. So therefore, it doesn't matter what you do in the valley, the enemy can sit above and watch. And that's what the enemy likes to do. He wants us in the valley. He wants us at a place where he has leverage over us. But God said, "You will not go in." But God said, "You are not going into the valley to fight. But you're going in the valley to worship." Let me ask you something. What are you doing in your valley? Israel was instructed to go into the valley to worship the Lord. The valley is a place of battle.
Mm-hmm.
The valley is a place of bloodshed.
Mm.
The valley is a place of loss and pain.
My Lord.
And they went into this valley not armed with weapons of war, but they went into this valley armed with worship. And this is amazing, because these three nations were coming up against Israel. And when God gave them the word, they responded in faith. They didn't go to the valley to fight. They went to worship. Mm-hmm. We can't miss this. And the Bible specifically says, it was when they began to worship the Lord that God set ambushments against all three nations and discomfited all of them. This is amazing, because Israel could have been discouraged and say, we're not even going to go to the valley. We're not going to go worship God, because they're still on their way. It is one thing for God to give you a word. It's another thing for you to believe the word. God gave them a word. Don't be afraid. God's going to fight for you. They said, okay. But even after God gave that word, he wasn't fighting at that time. But they believed the word nonetheless. And they believed the word enough to walk into a battle without weapons to praise God. Are you hearing me today? And what happened is, because they believed God, and because, watch this, and because they were moved by faith over the fear of the situation, God fought for them.
Yes.
And so when God gives you a word, believe him.
Amen.
When God gives you a word, walk according to the word that God gave you. It doesn't matter what the situation looks like. Believe what God told you.
Amen.
And this worship that Israel was engaged in, it wasn't a religious, dead-end, ritualistic worship. It was true worship. And I want to close with this passage, and we're going to pray. The Bible says on the fourth day, they assembled themselves in the valley of Baraka. For there they blessed the Lord. Therefore the name of the same place was called the Valley of Baraka unto this day.
Blessing, yes.
That word in the Hebrew means blessing. That word Baraka in the Hebrew means blessing. And what is interesting is the Bible specifically says that there they blessed the Lord. Therefore, because they blessed the Lord. Somebody say, because they blessed the Lord.
Because they blessed the Lord.
Therefore, because they blessed the Lord, the name of that same place. What is that same place? The Bible is saying the same place that was the valley of death. The same place that was the valley of bloodshed became the valley of blessing. And what God is saying to us is that when we bless him in the valley, he will change our valley of defeat.
Yes.
He will change our valley of depression. Mm-hmm. He will change our valley of anxiety. He will change that valley into a valley of blessing.
Amen.
It is amazing that we want to try to move out the valley, but what God is saying, no, stay right there and bless me. Amen. We're trying to get out of it, and God's saying, no. God is saying, stay right there, because if you bless me where you are, I will change that place from a place that was designed to bury you, a place that was designed to harm you, a place that was designed to end you. God is saying, I will take that same place and make it into a blessing in your life. Oh my goodness, you are not hearing me today. In other words, there are some things happening in your life. There are some valleys you're walking through, and God is saying, all I need you to do is bless me. Bless me in your valley. Praise me in your valley. Glorify my name in your valley. Glorify my name while you're there. And God says, as you praise me, I will change that entire situation and turn it around. That is why the Bible says God will prepare a table before you in the presence of your enemies, because listen,
Because listen, the place of loss can be a place where you will be fed. The place of loss can be a place where God will literally sustain you. The place where the enemy said, I'm going to bury you, I'm going to finish you, I'm going to end you, that same place where you thought it was all over. God says, no, stay right there and watch me work. God is saying, stay right there and watch what I'm going to do. I'm going to change your valley into a valley of blessing, a valley of healing, your valley of breakthrough. Tell somebody, God's about to change your valley.
God's about to change your valley.
He's about to change your valley. So I don't know what valley you are in. You can go ahead and dry your tears right now, because God is saying, I'm going to change you right where you are. He's saying, I'm going to change it right. Listen, don't run. Don't hide. I'm going to change it right where you are.
Yes.
Your valley will become your valley of blessing.
Thank you, Jesus.
Somebody clap your hands for the Lord if you believe it today. Yes.
Thank you, God.
He'll do it in your life. Your valley is about to become your valley of blessing. I want you to stand with me. We're going to pray. I want you to identify right now. Identify in your life what that valley is. And maybe your valley has different segments of it. Your valley can be multiple things. It can be multiple challenges. Mm-hmm. Whatever the valley is you are in, I want to give you an opportunity right now just to thank God in your own way while you're in your valley.
Jesus, thank you, Jesus, thank you, Jesus.
And we're doing this recognizing that as we thank him, as we worship him, that's when he begins to fight for us. Maybe your eyes have been set on the discouragement in your life. Maybe your heart has been overwhelmed with the difficulty of the reality of your situation. But God is saying today, if you will set your heart and put your eyes on me, and begin to thank me. We've been weeping about the problem. Mm-hmm. We've been whimpering about the difficulties.
Oh my God.
We've maintained sleepless nights because of what we are in. And all we see is the trial. All we see is the struggle. All we feel is the discouragement. All we feel is the weight of the burden. Mm-hmm. But God is saying to us today, if we will pivot and look to him, yes, the situation will be there, but God is saying, look at me. God is saying, look at my goodness. God is saying, remember my faithfulness.
Thank you, Jesus.
God is saying, recognize my ability in your life.
Thank you.
God is saying, if you will lift your eyes off of what you are in and place your eyes on who is in you, if you'll place your eyes on the Lord, he will begin to fight for you.
Yes.
For his eyes are searching to and fro the earth. Somebody who he can fight for, but he needs you to look at him.
Thank you, God. Thank you.
And so right now I want you to identify your valley. Yes, God, it's a valley of depression. Yes, God, it's a valley of loneliness. Yes, God, it's a valley of infirmity. Yes, God, it's a valley of anxiety. God, it's a valley of a multiplicity of things. As you identify your valley, take a moment and say, Father, I thank you for who you are.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank
say, God, I thank you while I'm in the valley.
Thank you, God.
Father, I thank you that in spite of all this, you are good.
Thank you, Jesus.
I thank you that in spite of all this, you are faithful. And yes, the enemy is swirling around my life to tear it down, but God, I worship you. Yes, God, things are going the wrong way, but God, I love you and I worship you. You are yet good in what is happening.
Thank you, God.
You are yet faithful in all that is going on in my life. Father, I thank you that, Lord, I thank you that you did not let this consume me. I yet have breath in my lungs. For as David said, the dead cannot praise you. But in my lungs you have placed breath, and so I will worship you.
Jesus.
And I will praise you. And we will say as the Hebrew boys, We will die believing God.
Yes.
We will die thanking God.
Thank you, Jesus.
Even if we die, we will yet praise Him.
Yes.
Oh God, we thank you today.
Thank you, Jesus.
Father, in spite of the valley, we worship you.
Yes, Lord.
Heavenly Father, in spite of the pain that we are riveting in right now, we give you glory.
Yes, Lord.
For our pain is not indicative of your faithfulness, but your faithfulness will mitigate our pain.
Thank you, Jesus.
And so, Father, today, as we walk through the valley of the shadow of anxiety, as we walk through the valley of the shadow of fear, as we walk through the valley of the shadow of pain, the shadow of depression, we say, as David said, we will fear no evil because you are with us.
Yes, yes.
We've gone through this valley, Lord God, not looking to you. We've gone through our valleys limping in our pain. But Father, just as Jehoshaphat declared, we declare today that we will set our hearts to seek you.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
For we find ourselves fighting the Moabs. We find ourselves fighting Ammonites in our lives. We find ourselves fighting battles on every side.
Jesus.
And we need you, oh God.
Yes, Lord.
And Father, we echo the words of Jehoshaphat, and we echo the words of Israel that we don't have the strength. We don't have the strength, oh God, to stand against the might of the multitude that is against us.
Jesus.
Nor do we know what to do. But God, our eyes are upon you.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Hallelujah. Our eyes are upon you because you know what to do.
Jesus. Yes, Jesus.
And so, Father, we lay down our lives into your hands.
Yes, God.
And I pray today, Lord, that you would fill your people with your joy.
Yes, Lord.
I pray in the name of Jesus that you would administer strength into the soul of your people.
Yes, God. Yes, God.
I pray, oh God, that you would open the windows of heaven.
Yes, Lord.
And pour into the lives of your people the strength for their broken souls.
Yes, Jesus. Yes, Jesus.
Pour from heaven, oh God, the strength that would help them to stand.
Yes, Jesus.
And grant them, oh God, the strength to lift their eyes to you one more time.
Yes, Jesus.
And grant them the strength to lift their voice, not to cry, not to weep, but grant them the strength like Job, that even in the midst of the loss, they will bless your name. That even in the midst of the trials, they will lift their hands in sacrifice and praise you anyway.
Thank you, Jesus.
That they would lift their hands in the midst of their loneliness.
Yes, Lord.
And worship you.
Yes, God.
And God, as they worship you, release the glory of your power.
Yes, Lord.
As they worship you, release the healing virtue of your spirit.
Yes, Jesus.
And fill their heart and their lives with your presence and goodness, that even in the storm, they will smile because they see you in the storm with them.
Lord, yes.
Holy Spirit, grant your people a revelation of you.
Yes.
That will strengthen them. Grant your people a revelation of you that will rejuvenate them. Grant them a revelation of you that will dispel the hopelessness in their heart.
Yes, Jesus.
That they would stand up bold and strong.
Yes, Lord.
Smiling in the storm, that they would stand up like the three Hebrew boys dancing in the fire, that they would stand up, oh God, that they would stand up like Daniel sitting there trusting you even in the lion's den. Oh God, do it in the lives of your people today.
Yes, Lord.
I pray today for supernatural resurrection in their lives. That the dead things will come alive again. That the dead in hope would come alive again. That dead in joy would come alive again. Oh God, bring them back to life.
Yes, God. Yes, God. Yes, God.
And so breathe your breath, O God, upon us one more time. And cause us to stand.
Thank you, God.
And we thank you for this.
Thank you.
In Jesus' name we all say.
Amen.
Amen. Come on and clap your hands for the Lord today. The Lord is good, because what God is saying to us, it doesn't matter what valley you are in. All you got to do is bless his name.
Yes.
All you got to do is bless his name.
Thank you,
and he
Jesus.
Will turn
Thank
that valley around. Listen, the enemy is mad because you received this word. And he's going to try to steal it from you. And what's going to happen is, when you go home tomorrow, he's going to try to make the situation feel worse. He's going to try he's going to try to make the situation, he's going to try to press you. But I want you to be determined that when the enemy shows up to discourage you tomorrow, or even today, say, Father, I bless you.
Yes.
When the situation, if it gets worse, you say, God, you are still good.
Yes, still good.
Because guess what? It always gets worse before the breakthrough.
Mm.
When somebody is holding on to something tight, they squeeze the hardest when they're about to lose their grip. That's what the enemy does. When he's about to lose the power and lose the hold, he squeezes. And so when the situation gets tougher, you got to understand it's about to break.
Yes.
Keep praising God.
Hallelujah.
Keep blessing his name.
Yes.
Keep worshiping him through the tears, through the pain. Say, God, you're still good. Lord, I'm hurting. And Lord, I'm struggling. Lord, I'm frustrated. But God, you are good. But continue to bless his name.
Yes.
And he will turn your valley into a valley of blessing. Come on, clap your hands for the Lord. Amen. Praise the Lord. If you're watching and you do not know the Lord, pray this prayer with us. Say, Father, I recognize I'm a sinner. Against you have I sinned only. Wash me, cleanse me, forgive me. Come into my heart and be my Lord. Change my life into a life of blessing. We thank you for this in Jesus' name. Amen. Leave us a message so we can pray with you and disciple you. Lone Terriers and Spares, we will be back with you next week. We love you. On behalf of First Lady and the entire Fountainside family, have a great week. Amen. Clap your hands for the Lord. Praise the name.